Yes, there's songs that tie into our season of the year as well. Good things to say. Well, we do have one thing that I would like to... I should have done it when I was making the announcement about it, but I told Pastor Brian Richard from Brook Ridge that I'd try to come up with a guess. We haven't talked, we haven't asked for an advance notice, but can you just give me a quick read? If you've not talked about going to the combined service on Good Friday over there with your family, I understand that, but if some of you are thinking about that, can you just raise your hand a little bit? This isn't a commitment. I'm just trying to say, okay, yeah, thank you. That's good enough. They're trying to plan accordingly, and I said, man, it's a shot in the dark. I don't know, and I'll try to find some information. So I appreciate that. Well, some of you are back into Hebrews 11. Your Bible almost automatically opens there. Maybe you put a marker in that since we've now are into our third message from this chapter. And I'll tell you, it is a struggle to think through how much you try to accomplish in a given message. It's a point that I have to decide. Do we keep going and try to make sure that we don't take forever to get through this book? It's been very rewarding for me. Or does the decision mean that you go into depth? And then I realized, you know, that's part of our lives. Decision making is all over the place. And some of the decisions we make are big ones, and some of them are not all that big. You can look in Scripture and you find out right in Genesis at the beginning, Adam was given a decision. Abel made a decision. So did Cain. And you walk through that process, and the writer of Hebrews in this section that we're in says, well, let's keep going. What about Noah? He made some. Abraham made some. And then I realized, oh, it's all over the place. You remember when Elijah was talking to the prophets of Baal, and he said, how long are you going to limp along between this trying to worship too? If God is God, worship him, and if Baal's the one, then worship him. Don't waffle on that. And Jesus said the same thing. You aren't going to make it if you try to serve two masters. It won't happen. It can't happen. Decisions are all over the place, and you can really tell the level of a maturity in a believer by some of the decisions they make. Now, there's the foundational ones here, and that's what the writer of Hebrews is talking about, that when we hear the word from God, his word, and then we orient or adjust our life based on that, that's a critically important decision. And it might happen in a moment, but there's this attitude that continues on. Now, some of our decisions that we make are not so significant. Guys, did any of you really struggle when you opened up the drawer that has all your socks in it today and say, oh, man, which ones? Man, which ones? I wonder what God's will is for the socks I put on. And your wife is saying, the ones that match something, okay? Work with me here. And then, or do you want lettuce on your sandwich? See, we make decisions all the time, all day long, and some of them are insignificant and others are pretty significant. Like, do we now pull up our family and move to another part of the United States to start a new job? I was given an opportunity that way. Should that be done? And that weighs a little differently on our scale, as it should. But when we're talking about the faith here, it is not a passive thing. It's taking God at his word in an active way. It's an intentional thing. This faith isn't brought out, we said this last week, to be put on display or help enhance something we're trying to get our minds around, but it's driven by something deep-seated. Because if you can pull it out for decorations, it can also be put away that way. So we're in to chapter 11, and it's been called by more than one. person, preacher, commentator, faith's Hall of Fame. Now, if we put that label over the top, there's this chance that some of us will assume that as we read these tributes to the characters in here, that somehow they came out with superhero capes. I mean, these guys, SB, super believer. They are unlike us in any way, shape, or form. And I think if that's what you have been thinking about, looking at these examples, the faith is exemplified through these people, you got to drop back and realize, do you know that they were just ordinary people? It's not so much about them as it is about God's faithfulness. The reason why they could place their confidence, their trust in them, orient their lives differently than they would if they did not have the Word of God, is because of who God is. So lay that alongside whatever else we see today, and we're going to see that these people are commended because of God's faithfulness, even when they were up and down in their walk with God. I hope that encourages you as it does me. So we're in chapter 11. Look at the very first part of verse 23. And it says this, by faith, Moses. And you might think, okay, we're going to talk about Moses. No, listen. By faith, Moses, when he was born, he was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw that the child was beautiful. And they were not afraid of the king's edict. Well, okay, so we really aren't talking about Moses yet, but we will. We're talking about his parents. They were willing to risk their lives, basically, because they were defying the order of Pharaoh. And they said that they saw that their son was beautiful. Well, what parent doesn't think their kids are beautiful? But something else is at work here, and I'm wondering somehow if there wasn't an element where they got some kind of sense from God that he was doing something significant. Why is it that they were the only ones that are recorded in Scripture? Maybe that's part of the plan. Do you know that while it says the parents saw that he was beautiful, when Stephen, before he was stoned for his faith in Acts 7, he's unfolding this message of the Old Testament, and he describes this in verses, well, really, 18 through 19, 20. You got this little glimpse of the scene from Stephen's perspective, and he says in that section that God thought that Moses was beautiful. I just think that that adds to the fact that somehow, perhaps the parents understood that God was at work here. So you can look at Exodus 2, 1 through 10. You'll see the whole scene expanded a little bit from what we have here. But just think about the faith that was needed. They're placing a vulnerable baby, young, very young. Could this child roll over yet? 3 months? I don't know. They put him in a basket. They put the basket in the Nile River. And then they walk back. Oh, yeah, Miriam's there. Right? Hiding in the weeds? The reeds? Yeah, okay, so just try that sometime, parents. You ready to do that? What questions come to your mind? How long is that crazy basket going to float? What happens if this baby shifts its weight to one side and tips it? Can water run in? What happens if the princess doesn't like this baby, recognizes this is a Hebrew child? Would she just leave it, sink it? Or if she does take this child out, how is Moses going to be raised according to the pagan Egyptian ways? Now you think about the faith that mom and dad had to demonstrate in this. Somehow in the mix, they were drawn to something bigger than themselves. It had to be. And then I think there's a wonderful encouragement here. Parents, we cannot genetically pass along our faith to our kids, but we can make an environment where that happens. I wonder what the impact was on Miriam. I'm supposed to watch, see what happens here, but they're trusting God collectively. Fantastic story. So we got the parents and the writers wanting us, the preacher that's telling his congregation, this doesn't want him to miss the role that the parents had. And then this little baby becomes a leader. And the story continues. Let's look back at this again. And if you want the scene details from here, you can just look back at Exodus 2, like I said, or Acts 7. You're going to see more of it here. Let's go on. And verse 24, it says, by faith Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. And by faith he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. And by faith he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch him. It's quite a little summary statement in a couple of verses of what went on in his life. How is it seen in this leader, Moses? He chose God's treasure over the culture's pleasures. We read that and we say, well, what is the treasures? It's the greater wealth. The greater wealth, the reproach of Christ. Over culture's pleasures. Do you realize what he had given up wasn't in itself wrong, perhaps? And he could live in a culture and enjoy the privileges and all that it offered and it not be sinful except for the plan that God had. If faith is hearing the word of God and adjusting life, well then, is that what he was doing here? It sure looks like it. I'm going to put my lot with the mistreated people of God than to keep the position and the prestige of the comforts that I would have growing up as a house of royalty there. I think it would have been terribly difficult. It is for us to give up the things that make us comfortable. I think it's harder when you live in that level and then back yourself out of them. I think that had to be it. It wasn't only this choosing God's treasure over culture's pleasure. You see another comparison. He chooses the invisible over the visible. The reproach of Christ is specifically mentioned here. I find that intriguing. The reproach of Christ, he lived 1,500 years before Jesus walked on this earth. The writer specifically identifies the anointed one, the Messiah, and he chooses the invisible. Jesus wasn't on the scene. There was a promise coming, but who knows when, who knows all the details on it, over that what else was he contrasting that to? Pharaoh's rule was pretty visible. The power and the position that he had, the declarations that he would make, the control that he had over that country was enormous. It's quite visible. He also, Moses, took the invisible promise of God and responded with a visible action. Did you see what when he kept the Passover? He puts the blood on the doorpost to his house and across the top. Why? Because God said, do it, and the angel of destruction and death will not come to you. Again, doing something physical out of what he couldn't see. All he had was the word of God, and he acted in that way. I think it is also fascinating to me that we have two people mentioned in this chapter, both of whom were in Egypt. Joseph was one, Moses the other. Joseph lived his entire life in that culture. In fact, he married a wife from that culture, had two kids. He died. You remember all that. He never gave up the position that God placed him in because God's plan for him was that he would protect and feed the nation of Israel because of Joseph's role. Now we come along and those same people need to be delivered. And so God has another plan. So it is wrong for Moses to stay there and say, hey, I don't care what God's plan is. I don't care what the redemptive picture is that we're going after here. He didn't even understand it at the early part, but he did obey. I think there's a takeaway there we ought to be conscious of as well. So Moses was used to deliver, and he identified with them. So not only do we have this faith being showcased in the life of a leader, but then the text goes on, and it what about those that followed him? And we've got this simple verse. Verse 29, do you see it there? By faith, the people crossed the Red Sea as on dry land, but the Egyptians, when they attempted to do the same, were drowned. That's it. That's the whole thing. You want the scene details, Exodus 14. You can go unpack that. But I would just tell you this, that it is possible that you could read that verse and then you'd forget about everything we talked about last week. How you trust God, even if you don't understand the when and the how and the how long things are going to happen and all of that, you trust God anyway. Now think, you got Moses, he's looking at the sea, the Red Sea is right in front of him, and behind him is the elite of the army, the chariots, those of Pharaoh's that are coming, and who's he surrounded by? A whole bunch of people that are grumbling and complaining and arguing with him. We can look at that and we'd say, man, what do you got, Moses? Well, he says, I got a stick and I got a promise from God. Hey, yeah, but it kind of stinks to be you. Don't you understand? The Egyptians are coming after you and your own people have kind of turned against you. And he said, but I'm not worried. In fact, there's something fascinating that happens. He decides, the story goes on, and you know what it is. The rod comes out and the waters split on the Red Sea. Israel acted on the promise. But we get there pretty quickly, don't we? I think it's fascinating that in the expanded version of the scene, in Exodus 14, it says in verse 8 that the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he pursued the people of Israel while the people of Israel were going out defiantly. You know what that word defiantly means? Triumphantly, literally, raising the hand. Hey, this is great. We're finally leaving our Egyptian bondage. They're going out with a great focus and marching right out there, and everything's good. The next verse, the Egyptians pursued all Pharaoh's horses and chariots and his horsemen and his army, overtook them and camped by the sea. When Pharaoh drew near, the people of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them, and they feared greatly. And the people of Israel cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in this wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Two verses later, they come out celebrating God's deliverance, and as soon as they look around and see, then they're ready to just say, what are you doing? You got to be the worst leader ever. Now, I love the fact that God isn't a one failure and you're done kind of God. I'm tremendously encouraged with that, because even though they suddenly turned like on a dime as soon as they saw the circumstances change, God doesn't leave them there. Moses does what he's supposed to do. Moses doesn't give a thought to how is this going to happen. He's just doing what God tells him to do and let God figure out how to put the water up. And he did. And the Israelites then have to demonstrate faith, every single one of them. They have to go down into that dry seabed. And can you imagine what that would have looked like? We aren't talking a 10-foot stream crossing. This would have taken hours. They're bringing everything they have, animals, kids, stuff, wagons, whatever they had. You know it wasn't backing up a minivan and going. And what happened? They're watching and they're in this process to get across. And you see that God takes them along. Your faith is weak? Here. Just go here. And he leads them through. I love that picture. They acted on the promise and they needed to have their faith strengthened. God will strengthen us even in our weakness. Don't miss this. These are normal people. Normal people. They are not superheroes. Do you remember what we just read? Well, so the Egyptians tried it. They attempted to do the same and they drowned. But why? Because they were looking at the program saying, all right, hey, that this cloud thing that was stopping us, that the darkness that we couldn't see is now removed. Hey, it's easier to see. Now we'll just proceed. They're ahead of us now. They got in through the sea. That's crazy. We're going to go in too. They presumed that because Israel was getting through there, that they could continue on. Is that what God had planned? No. No. He ended their pursuit right there, bringing the waters over them. Why? Because the Egyptian army did not have the promise of God. This wasn't their faith. They were presuming that what was going on, it looked like a program that they could participate in. They just did it. Can I stop? Parker, study for a moment and just ask this question. Do you think that it's possible in the people that are part of our Calvary worship, whether it's online or in person, for people to be presuming something about their connection with God? Because they're part of the same program. They're enjoying, everybody enjoys the same music, and it is possible. Because you could come in here and be struck with the joy of singing. Or you meet nice people that actually care about you and say, I'm going to pray for you and help you, whatever. And you're drawn to that, but maybe missing the connection of faith. And maybe what's here is faith, but it's not personal. You haven't come to the spot where you said, wait, this faith has to be personal. It means that my relationship with God is dependent upon my acknowledging that I can't possibly be good enough for God to accept me in my sin. There's only one solution. That's to trust Jesus' work on the cross. And it is possible that we could have people here every week. And you might be presuming that because you're with the people of God, that everything's good. The Egyptians presumed, and they met their death. I say that not having anybody in particular in mind. I ask the question because we don't know the hearts of people. You only know where you are. Ask yourself that question. You know, we look at this one and done kind of thing, and we say, yeah, God's not sidelined us because of our weak faith. What would that look like? We could get up on any given morning. Now, whether we're talking to the adults that have jobs to go to, people to see, things to do, all that stuff, or young people that are in school, going to school, you could get up early. Now, at 6 o'clock, let's make it 5:45. You're getting up really early, and you're pumped, man. This is the day I'm going to speak out for the cause of Christ, and I'm going to figure out how to do that at school or at the job, wherever it is. And so you get little intake from the Word of God, and you spend some time praying a bit, and then you have your cereal and your OJ or coffee, whatever it is, and you're determined, boy, this is the day that the Lord's made. I'm going to rejoice and be glad. Lord, I can just sense this is the day I'm going to be able to speak to someone about my faith in you. And you're no later than 15 minutes arriving at work or school. And your coworker, fellow students, the one right next to you, are in a terrible mood. I mean, life's not going well. And then you realize that that's not just localized in that person, that the supervisors and other coworkers are grumpy. Things didn't go right. Somebody's chewing on them, so everybody's dead. And you just start saying, ooh, this doesn't look like a good day to witness. I think I'll just shut up. And I'll just keep my head down and whatever, because I'm shaking. See, if I try it right now, I know what's going to happen. It's not going to be received well. And we try to do that. And then what does God do in that? Does he set us off to the side and say, sorry, I guess you missed your chance. You're done. I'm going to go back and find people that are faithful, regardless of circumstances. No, in that weakness, he brings us along, and we learn from that, and we realize that our confidence is not in how well we are stacked up against the circumstances. Our confidence is in him. I think this simple sentence about Israel being commended for their faith. Israel, the ones that griped about manna, the ones that griped about no meat, the ones that griped about no water. Pick your spot in the journey. They were griping about all kinds of things. And yet here they're held up as a picture of faith. We got to keep moving here. The next story is an outsider. And now we're moving into the season of Joshua and the Battle of Jericho. And of course, we've got Rahab. Here's what it says in verse 30. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they'd been circled for 7 days. By faith, Rahab, the prostitute, did not perish with those who were disobedient because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies. Okay, if you want the scene expanded a bit, look in Joshua 2 and Joshua 6, and you're going to find these stories here. And is there anybody here who does not know the story of Joshua and the Battle of Jericho or Rahab? Can I see hands? It would take a little boldness, maybe. You know what this means? I'm going to assume that everybody within this circle here has heard it. Would you do me a favor? I love telling the story to people that haven't heard it, so just act like you haven't heard it before. Because when you do that, you might pick up something you did not recognize before. It's possible. So Joshua chapter 6, verse 1 tells us Jericho's a walled city. It's a fortress, man. It says it's tight. No one's going out. No one's coming in. It's locked up. And there were two walls, an exterior one and an interior one. And that's proven in the excavations. And so what were the instructions? Okay, we're going to line the army up. And let's see, we need 7 priests to carry the ram's horn. And they did that. And they had the Ark of the Covenant. And then the rear guard comes in because that's what the rear guard does. They come in later. And they're commanded, you go around the city wall, and I don't want you saying anything. And they do that. Day one is there. Can you imagine what that would have been like for the watchmen on the wall? They know Israel's coming out there someplace. They've heard what's happened in other spots. And these people didn't come up tight to the wall, I'm sure of that. But they, in the amount of time it would have taken to encircle that spot, it's probably about 9 acres total inside the walls. It would have taken them maybe an hour, hour and a half, depending on the terrain, to get through that. And they're walking around. They get to the end of that, and then the commander says, "All right, men, thanks. We'll see you tomorrow. Don't be late. Look sharp." They come back the next day and do the same thing the next day. And now the conversation between the watchmen up there is, and here they come. They're always carrying that box with them, that ark. Don't know what that all means. So the same thing's happening. Maybe it's a reconnaissance mission. They aren't close enough that we can inflict any damage on them, but what's going on? Seventh day. They're up at dawn assembling themselves together. And they get around that time, seven times. Now the horns are blowing and the people are shouting and the walls come down. You realize that the enablement that God needed to do, you think that that was a piece of cake. Well, man, there's no siege going on here. They're just walking around and the walls come down. Yeah, okay, how many times? Seven. Just 7, 8, 9 miles maybe that they had to hike. Okay, do that. And now the walls come down. I got to go in and fight. And they did. I said all the walls came down, but they didn't. There was one section where it didn't, on the north side. The closest spot to the Judean hillside, the closest distance there, and there was a house building in that remaining section. Who would have thought? See, the archaeologists thought for sure that they would be able to discredit the Bible before they got in there and discovered what was there. And the grain was still stored in there. Why? Because it was told, don't take anything unless it's the treasures that will be brought into the Lord's house, the treasury there. No grain, no spoils that way. It's an amazing thing. So that house, yeah, that was Rahab's. You think about the outsider story here, and Rahab was at a prostitute, did not have a reputable track record. And what does she do? She doesn't know much about God, Yahweh, but what she knows, she acts upon. And so when the spies were there and tell her, listen, you've shown us kindness, she even lied. She told the people, they got away, go chase them. You probably should overtake them in no time flat, all the while knowing they were on the roof. She didn't know everything about God, but she knew something and acted upon it. You put the cord out the window, bring your family in if you want them protected, and you will be. And she did. So she did not perish with those who were disobedient because she had given that. After the battle, she marries an Israelite, Solomon. And Rahab gives birth to a son named Boaz. Boaz is in the line that gives none other than King David and the line of Christ the faith that she had. We've got to just touch on these. You're going to have to do the finish work on this. This next section talks about the people that had tremendous victories. Please note the listing of the names, and I'd ask you this. Were they perfectly consistent in their lives? Anything in Samson's life that you want to repeat in your life or your kid's life? I want them to be able to follow God and be strengthened by God. Yeah, but what about the rest? And not so much. Well, what about David? Was there anything that we could criticize in David's life where he got off track and wound up killing a man and claiming another woman as his wife? Yeah, that's not so good either. And you look it through, and you're watching the reality here, and I keep telling that the point here isn't the people's faithfulness. It's this. So he writes in broad lines, speaking the stories here because he knows his people have heard all of these. They know the stories well. But lest you think it's all about the victories and establishing kingdoms, no. The next section says, hey, some of these people got stoned. Some got sawn in two. What a terrible way to die. In fact, tradition says Isaiah the prophet was cut in two like that. And you go through this thing and you realize this isn't a sales pitch for just, hey, trust Jesus and everything's going to be just great. It's going to be hard. But what he's saying is that even if it is that way, you trust because God is faithful in the storyline. You see the fortitude amid the hostility and the persecutions. It isn't possible to foresee this as all, you know, Red Sea crossing events, mountaintop experiences with God. You see people that are still faithful, even though their very lives are gone. I feel badly that we don't have time to drive this part of it home. I want to take a couple minutes. Would you just ask, is this kind of faith present in you? I'm not talking about the consistency stuff, but that there's a determination to say, no, I've got to be about this. That the message of this passage should challenge any of our operating frameworks. It should show up. If this faith was visible to others that watched them, is your faith visible to those that watch you? As somebody might be watching you and they know that the Bible says you shouldn't steal. But if you come into work tomorrow 15 minutes late and you leave 30 minutes early and you're only putting in half the energy throughout the day, you've just sent a great message about Christianity and it's not good. Because the diligence isn't there on that. If somebody knows that you're supposed to love God more than anything else, but they'll watch to see if that reflects in how you live your life. When the circumstances come in, will they see that life there? And if they don't, ask yourself, what do I need to do to fix that? In fact, look at your life and think, where is it that I know the Word of God says something, and I'm off in that area, so you start making the life adjustments that make some kind of consistency. See, it doesn't matter if your bumper sticker says God is pro-life, if you've erased it with other things that confuse it. And by all means, I'm not saying cover up the God is pro-life bumper sticker. The honk if you love Jesus bumpers. That's not the point. The point is watch because the maturity of a believer will be seen in how they pursue obedience, not whether they hit it all the time. So can you do that? And then just the message was written so that the people of his day would persevere in spite of the circumstances. We are in the same spot as they were. That's the message that has to land on us. Let's ask God for that kind of help. And please, if you are putting the pieces of faith together, you are wondering whether you've been presuming on something that needs to be clarified, please bring the questions where we can talk about those. Whether it's to me personally, another believer here, it doesn't matter. The important thing is that you have that conversation so you understand. Father, I thank you very much for your clarity in the Word of God. I pray that you would give us the ability to lean on you and to correct when we get off and get off base in our pursuit of what pleases you. I'm counting, Father, on your word, your spirit to draw people to yourself. But I thank you for these clear examples. We see the flawed men and women that you've said that they still can trust you because you are faithful. Help us to that end and give us opportunities this week to be pointing others to you as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for your additional attention. You are dismissed.